This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording by Nicholas James Bridgewater. Chapter 26 of A Child's History of England. King Henry VII did not turn out to be as fine a fellow as the nobility and people hoped in the first joy of their deliverance from Richard III. He was cold, crafty, and calculating, and would do almost anything for money. He possessed considerable ability, but his chief merit appears to have been that he was not cruel when there was nothing to be got by it. The new king had promised the nobles who had espoused his cause that he would marry the Princess Elizabeth. The first thing he did was to direct her to be removed from the castle of Sheriff Hutton in Yorkshire, where Richard had placed her, and restored to the care of her mother in London. The young Earl of Warwick, Edward Plantagenet, son and heir of the Duke of Clarence, had been kept a prisoner in the same old Yorkshire castle with her. This boy, who was now 15, the new king placed in the Tower for safety. Then he came to London in great state, and gratified the people with a fine procession, on which kind of show he often very much relied for keeping them in good humour. The sports and feasts which took place were followed by a terrible fever, called the sweating sickness, of which great numbers of people died. Lord mayors and aldermen are thought to have suffered most from it, whether because they were in the habit of overeating themselves, or because they were very jealous of preserving filth and nuisances in the city, as they have been since, I don't know. The king's coronation was postponed on account of the general ill health, and he afterwards deferred his marriage, as if he were not very anxious that it should take place, and even, after that, deferred the queen's coronation, so long that he gave offence to the York party. However, he set these things right in the end, by hanging some men, and seizing on the rich possessions of others, by granting more popular pardons to the followers of the late king than could at first be got from him, and by employing about his court some very scrupulous persons who had been employed in the previous reign. As this reign was principally remarkable for two very curious impostures, which have become famous in history, we will make those two stories its principal feature. There was a priest at Oxford of the name of Simons, who had for a pupil a handsome boy named Lambert Simnel, the son of a baker. Partly to gratify his own ambitious ends, and partly to carry out the designs of a secret party formed against the king, this priest declared that his pupil, the boy, was no other than the young Earl of Warwick, who, as everybody might have known, was safely locked up in the Tower of London. The priest and the boy went over to Ireland, and at Dublin enlisted in the cause all ranks of the people, who seemed to have been generous enough, but exceedingly irrational. The Earl of Kildare, the governor of Ireland, declared that he believed the boy to be what the priest represented, and the boy, who had been tutored by the priest, told them such things of his childhood, and gave them so many descriptions of the royal family, that they were perpetually shouting and hurrahing, and drinking his health, and making all kinds of noisy and thirsty demonstrations to express their belief in him. Nor was this feeling confined to Ireland alone, for the Earl of Lincoln, whom the late usurper had named as his successor, went over to the young pretender, and after holding a secret correspondence with the Dowager Duchess of Burgundy, the sister of Edward IV, who detested the present king and all his race, sailed to Dublin with 2,000 German soldiers of her providing. In this promising state of the boy's fortunes, he was crowned there, with a crown taken off the head of a statue of the Virgin Mary, and was then, according to the Irish custom of those days, carried home on the shoulders of a big chieftain possessing a great deal more strength and sense. Father Simons, you may be sure, was mighty busy at the coronation. 10 days afterwards the Germans and the Irish and the priest and the boy and the Earl of Lincoln all landed in Lancashire to invade England. The king, who had good intelligence of their movements, set up his standard at Nottingham, where vast numbers resorted to him every day, while the Earl of Lincoln could gain but very few. With his small force he tried to make for the town of Newark, but the king's army, getting between him and that place, he had no choice but to risk a battle at Stoke. It soon ended in the complete destruction of the Pretender's forces, one half of whom were killed, among them the Earl himself. The priest and the baker's boy were taken prisoners. The priest, after confessing the trick, was shut up in prison, where he afterwards died. Suddenly, perhaps, the boy was taken into the king's kitchen and made a turnspit. He was afterwards raised to the station of one of the king's falconers, and so ended this strange imposition. There seems reason to suspect that the Dowager Queen, always a restless and busy woman, had some share in tutoring the baker's son. The king was very angry with her, whether or no. He seized upon her property and shut her up in a convent at Bermondsey. One might suppose that the end of this story would have put the Irish people on their guard, but they were quite ready to receive a second impostor, as they had received the first, and that same troublesome Duchess of Burgundy soon gave them the opportunity. All of a sudden there appeared at Cork, in a vessel arriving from Portugal, a young man of excellent abilities, of very handsome appearance, and most winning manners, who declared himself to be Richard, Duke of York, the second son of King Edward IV. "Oh," said some, even of those ready Irish believers, "but surely that young prince was murdered by his uncle in the Tower." "It is supposed so," said the engaging young man, "and my brother was killed in that gloomy prison, but I escaped, it doesn't matter how at present, and have been wandering about the world for 7 long years. This explanation being quite satisfactory to numbers of the Irish people, they began again to shout and to hurrah, and to drink his health, and to make the noisy and thirsty demonstrations all over again. And the big chieftain in Dublin began to look out for another coronation, and another young king to be carried home on his back. Now, King Henry being then on bad terms with France, the French king, Charles VIII, saw that by pretending to believe in the handsome young man, he could trouble his enemies sorely. So he invited him over to the French court, and appointed him a bodyguard, and treated him in all respects as if he really were the Duke of York. Peace, however, being soon concluded between the two kings, the pretended duke was turned adrift, and wandered for protection to the Duchess of Burgundy. She, after feigning to inquire into the reality of his claims, declared him to be the very picture of her dear departed brother, gave him a bodyguard at her court of 30 halberdiers, and called him by the sounding name of the White Rose of England. The leading members of the White Rose party in England sent over an agent named Sir Robert Clifford to ascertain whether the White Rose's claims were good. The king also sent over his agents to inquire into the Rose's history. The White Roses declared the young man to be really the Duke of York. The king declared him to be Perkin Warbeck, the son of a merchant of the city of Tournai, who had acquired his knowledge of England, its language and manners, from the English merchants who traded in Flanders. It was also stated by the royal agents that he had been in the service of Lady Brompton, the wife of an exiled English nobleman, and that the Duchess of Burgundy had caused him to be trained and taught, expressly for this deception. The king then required the Archduke Philip, who was the sovereign of Burgundy, to banish this new pretender, or to deliver him up. But as the Archduke replied that he could not control the Duchess in her own land, the king, in revenge, took the market of English cloth away from Antwerp, and prevented all commercial intercourse between the two countries. He also, by arts and bribes, prevailed on Sir Robert Clifford to betray his employers, and he, denouncing several famous English noblemen as being secretly the friends of Perkin Warbeck, the king had 3 of the foremost executed at once. Whether he pardoned the remainder because they were poor, I do not know. but it is only too probable that he refused to pardon one famous nobleman against whom the same Clifford soon afterwards informed separately, because he was rich. This was no other than Sir William Stanley, who had saved the king's life at the Battle of Bosworth Field. It is very doubtful whether his treason amounted to much more than his having said that if he were sure the young man were the Duke of York, he would not take arms against him. Whatever he had done, he admitted, like an honourable spirit, and he lost his head for it, and the covetous king gained all his wealth. Perkin Warbeck kept quiet for 3 years, but as the Flemings began to complain heavily of the loss of their trade by the stoppage of the Antwerp market on this account, and as it was not unlikely that they might even go so far as to take his life, or give him up, he found it necessary to do something. Accordingly, he made a desperate sally, and landed with only a few hundred men on the coast of Deal. But he was soon glad to get back to the place from whence he came, for the country people rose against his followers, killed a great many, and took 150 prisoners, who were all driven to London, tied together with ropes like a team of cattle. Every one of them was hanged on some part or other of the seashore, in order that if any more men should come over with Perkin Warbeck, they might see the bodies as a warning before they landed. Then the wary king, by making a treaty of commerce with the Flemings, drove Perkin Warbeck out of that country, and by completely gaining over the Irish to his side, deprived him of that asylum too. He wandered away to Scotland and told his story at that court. King James the Fourth of Scotland, who was no friend to King Henry, and had no reason to be, for King Henry had bribed his Scotch lords to betray him more than once, but had never succeeded in his plots, gave him a great reception, and called him his cousin, and gave him in marriage the Lady Catherine Gordon, a beautiful and charming creature related to the royal house of Stuart. Alarmed by the successful reappearance of the Pretender, the king still undermined, and bought and bribed, and kept his doings and Perkin Warbeck's story in the dark, when he might, one would imagine, have rendered the matter clear to all England. But for all this bribing of the Scotch lords at the Scotch king's court, he could not procure the Pretender to be delivered up to him. James, though not very particular in many respects, would not betray him, and the ever-busy Duchess of Burgundy so provided him with arms, and good soldiers, and with money besides, that he had soon a little army of 1,500 men of various nations. With these, and aided by the Scottish king in person, he crossed the border into England, and made a proclamation to the people, in which he called the king Henry Tudor, offered large rewards to any one who should take or distress him, and announced himself as King Richard the Fourth, come to receive the homage of his faithful subjects. His faithful subjects, however, cared nothing for him, and hated his faithful troops, who, being of different nations, quarrelled also among themselves. Worse than this, if worse were possible, they began to plunder the country, upon which the White Rose said that he would rather lose his rights than gain them through the miseries of the English people. The Scottish king made a jest of his scruples, but they and their whole force went back again without fighting a battle. The worst consequence of this attempt was that a rising took place among the people of Cornwall, who considered themselves too heavily taxed to meet the charges of the expected war. Stimulated by Flammock, a lawyer, and Joseph, a blacksmith, and joined by Lord Audley and some other country gentlemen, they marched on all the way to Deptford Bridge, where they fought a battle with the king's army. They were defeated, though the Cornish men fought with great bravery, and the lord was beheaded, and the lawyer and the blacksmith were hanged, drawn, and quartered. The rest were pardoned. The king, who believed every man to be as avaricious as himself, and thought that money could settle anything, allowed them to make bargains for their liberty with the soldiers who had taken them. Perkin Warbeck, doomed to wander up and down, and never to find rest anywhere, a sad fate, almost a sufficient punishment for an imposture, which he seems in time to have half believed himself, lost his Scottish refuge through a truce being made between the two kings, and found himself once more without a country before him in which he could lay his head. But James, always honourable and true to him, alike when he melted down his plate, and even the great gold chain he had been used to wear, to pay soldiers in his cause, and now, when that cause was lost and hopeless, did not conclude the treaty until he had safely departed out of the Scottish dominions. He and his beautiful wife, who was faithful to him under all reserves, and left her state and home to follow his poor fortunes, were put aboard a ship with everything necessary for their comfort and protection, and sailed for Ireland. But the Irish people had had enough of counterfeit Earls of Warwick and Dukes of York for one while, and would give the White Rose no aid. So the White Rose, encircled by thorns indeed, resolved to go with his beautiful wife to Cornwall as a forlorn resource, and see what might be made of the Cornish men, who had risen so valiantly a little while before, and who had fought so bravely at Deptford Bridge. To Whitsun Bay, in Cornwall accordingly, came Perkin Warbeck and his wife, and the lovely lady he shut up for safety in the castle of St. Michael's Mount, and then marched into Devonshire at the head of 3,000 Cornishmen. These were increased to 6,000 by the time of his arrival in Exeter, but there the people made a stout resistance, and he went on to Taunton, where he came in sight of the king's army. The stout Cornish men, although they were few in number and badly armed, were so bold that they never thought of retreating, but bravely looked forward to a battle on the morrow. Unhappily for them, the man who was possessed of so many engaging qualities, and who attracted so many people to his side, when he had nothing else with which to tempt them, was not as brave as they. In the night, when the two armies lay opposite to each other, he mounted a swift horse and fled. When morning dawned, the poor confiding Cornish men, discovering that they had no leader, surrendered to the king's power. Some of them were hanged, and the rest were pardoned, and went miserably home. Before the king pursued Perkin Warbeck to the sanctuary of Beaulieu in the New Forest, where it was soon known that he had taken refuge, he sent a body of horsemen to St. Michael's Mount to seize his wife. She was soon taken and brought as a captive before the king, but she was so beautiful and so good, and so devoted to the man in whom she believed, that the king regarded her with compassion, treated her with great respect, and placed her at court near the queen's person. And many years after Perkin Warbeck was no more, and when his strange story had become like a nursery tale, she was called the White Rose by the people in remembrance of her beauty. The sanctuary of Beaulieu was soon surrounded by the king's men, and the king, pursuing his usual dark, artful ways, sent pretended friends to Perkin Warbeck to persuade him to come out and surrender himself. This he soon did, the king having taken a good look at the man of whom he had heard so much, from behind a screen, directed him to be well mounted, and to ride behind him, at a little distance, guarded, but not bound in any way. So they entered London with the king's favourite show, a procession, and some of the people hooted as the pretender rode slowly through the streets to the tower, but the greater part were quiet, and very curious to see him. From the tower he was taken to the palace at Westminster, and there lodged like a gentleman, though closely watched. He was examined every now and then as to his imposture, but the king was so secret in all he did, that even then he gave it a consequence which it cannot be supposed to have in itself deserved. At last Perkin Warbeck ran away, and took refuge in another sanctuary near Richmond in Surrey. From this he was again persuaded to deliver himself up, and being conveyed to London, he stood in the stocks for a whole day, outside Westminster Hall, and there read a paper purporting to be his full confession, and relating his story as the king's agents had originally described it. He was then shut up in the tower again, in the company of the Earl of Warwick, who had now been there for 14 years, ever since his removal out of Yorkshire, except when the king had had him at court, and had shown him to the people, to prove the imposture of the baker's boy. It is but too probable, when we consider the crafty character of Henry the Seventh, that these two were brought together for a cruel purpose. A plot was soon discovered between them, and the keepers, to murder the governor get possession of the keys, and proclaim Perkin Warbeck as King Richard IV. That there was some such plot is likely. That they were tempted into it is at least as likely. That the unfortunate Earl of Warwick, last male of the Plantagenet line, was too unused to the world, and too ignorant and simple to know much about it, whatever it was, is perfectly certain, and that it was the king's interest to get rid of him is no less so. He was beheaded on Tower Hill, and Perkin Warbeck was hanged at Tyburn. Such was the end of the pretended Duke of York, whose shadowy history was made more shadowy, and ever will be, by the mystery and craft of the king. If he had turned his great natural advantages to a more honest account, he might have lived a happy and respected life, even in those days. But he died upon a gallows at Tyburn, leaving the Scottish lady who had loved him so well, kindly protected at the Queen's court. After some time, she forgot her old loves and troubles, as many people do with time's merciful assistance, and married a Welsh gentleman. Her second husband, Sir Matthew Cradock, more honest and more happy than her first, lies beside her in a tomb in the old church of Swansea. The ill blood between France and England in this reign arose out of the continued plotting of the Duchess of Burgundy and disputes respecting the affairs of Brittany. The king feigned to be very patriotic, indignant, and warlike, but he always contrived so as never to make war in reality, and always to make money. His taxation of the people on pretence of war with France involved at one time a very dangerous insurrection headed by Sir John Egremont and a common man called John O'Chambre. But it was subdued by the royal forces under the command of the Earl of Surrey. The knighted John escaped to the Duchess of Burgundy, who was ever ready to receive anyone who gave the king trouble, and the plain John was hanged at York, in the midst of a number of his men, but on a much higher gibbet, as being a greater traitor. Hung high or hung low, however, hanging is much the same to the person hung. Within a year after her marriage, the queen had given birth to a son, who was called Prince Arthur, in remembrance of the old British prince of romance and story, and who, when all these events had happened, being then in his 15th year, was married to Catherine, the daughter of the Spanish monarch, with great rejoicings and bright prospects. But in a very few months he sickened and died. As soon as the king had recovered from his grief, he thought it a pity that the fortune of the Spanish princess, amounting to 200,000 crowns, should go out of the family, and therefore arranged that the young widow should marry his second son Henry, then 12 years of age, when he too should be 15. There were objections to this marriage on the part of the clergy, but as the infallible Pope was gained over, and, as he must be right, that settled the business for the time. The king's eldest daughter was provided for, and a long course of disturbance was considered to be set at rest by her being married to the Scottish king. And now the queen died. When the king had got over that grief too, his mind once more reverted to his darling money for consolation, and he thought of marrying the Dowager Queen of Naples, who was immensely rich, but, as it turned out, not to be practicable to gain the money, however practicable it might have been to gain the lady. He gave up the idea. He was not so fond of her, but that he soon proposed to marry the Dowager Duchess of Savoy, and soon afterwards the widow of the King of Castile, who was raving mad, but he made a money bargain instead, and married neither. The Duchess of Burgundy, among the other discontented people to whom she had given refuge, had sheltered Edmund de la Pole, younger brother of that Earl of Lincoln who was killed at Stoke, now Earl of Suffolk. The king had prevailed upon him to return to the marriage of Prince Arthur, but he soon afterwards went away, and then the king, suspecting a conspiracy, resorted to his favourite plan of sending him some treacherous friends, and buying of those scoundrels the secrets they disclosed or invented. Some arrests and executions took place in consequence. In the end the king, on a promise of not taking his life, obtained possession of the person of Edmund de la Pole, and shut him up in the Tower. This was his last enemy. If he had lived much longer, he would have made many more among the people, by the grinding exaction to which he constantly exposed them, and by the tyrannical acts of his two prime favourites in all money-raising matters, Edmund Dudley and Richard Empson. But death, the enemy who is not to be bought off or deceived, and on whom no money and no treachery has any effect, presented himself at this juncture, and ended the king's reign. He died of the gout on the 22nd of April 1509, and in the 53rd year of his age, after reigning 24 years, he was buried in the beautiful chapel of Westminster Abbey, which he had himself founded, and which still bears his name. It was in this reign that the great Christopher Columbus, on behalf of Spain, discovered what was then called the New World, great wonder, interest, and hope of wealth being awakened in England thereby. The king and the merchants of London and Bristol fitted out an English expedition for further discoveries in the New World, and entrusted it to Sebastian Cabot of Bristol, the son of a Venetian pilot there. He was very successful in his voyage, and gained high reputation, both for himself and England. End of chapter 26.